In the Old Testament, Jesus said, "All who hate me love death." Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Accepting him as your Lord and Savior and choosing to follow him puts you on the way. Obeying the truth of God's word keeps you on the way that ends in eternal life. Your eternal destiny will be determined by your choices in this world. Steps to Life exists to help people find the way, the truth, and the life.
Glad to be able to study God's Word with you today during our worship service. And I've entitled my few remarks today, "Will You Be Passed By?" Now, there are times when you want to be passed by. When my wife and I went to a wedding in Texas, a few weeks ago, we were trying to find the church, and so I thought from the information we had that I needed that it had to be right there. So I got in the right turn lane, and I drove in the right turn lane for probably two blocks, and there were several places you could turn right, and I never turned right, and I saw that wasn't where I wanted to go, so put the left turn signal on and pulled out of that where the right turn right only lane and pulled back into the right. Well, there was a policeman sitting right there in the parking lot, watched me just driving down this right lane for a long time and never turning, and then putting my signal on, turned back. So he decided I better check this out. So he started following me. And I was very happy when he later passed me by. But there are times when you do not want to be passed by. And that's what I'm going to study with you about today. And the tragedy is that most people get passed by. We'll look at that in just a moment. But first, let's pray and ask the Lord to help us understand what we're going to study from His holy word. Father in heaven, we thank you for the privilege that we have to study your word, that we still live in a country where we have freedom of assembly. And we earnestly pray right now that you'll help us to understand what we read, what we study, and be able to make a practical application of it in our living. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. In our preaching revival service last Sabbath, I read this statement that was written in the Review and Herald, March 22, 1897. Ellen White wrote, "A revival of true godliness among us is the greatest and most urgent of all our needs. To seek this should be our first work." Is there going to be a revival? There is. Let me read it to you from prophecy. This is from the book Great Controversy, 464. "Before the final visitation of God's judgments upon the earth, there will be among the people of the Lord such a revival of primitive godliness as has not been witnessed since apostolic times." So is there going to be one? There is going to be a revival of primitive godliness such as has not been seen since apostolic times. In other words, there is going to be a great reformation that will be worldwide. Now, the tragedy that we're going to look at is that most people, even the people that think they're going to be involved in it, are not going to get involved in it. They're going to be passed by. So let's read about it. Look in your Bible, the Gospel of John. The 8th chapter. We read John 8:59, and then we'll read John 9, verse 1. "Then they took up stones to throw at him. But Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple, going through the midst of them, and so passed by. Now as Jesus passed by, he saw a man who was blind from birth." Now, these people that were picking up the stones, they belong to a church, what we would call a church, a group of people called, they call themselves Israel, the children of Abraham. They were a group of people that had been looking for over 1,000 years for the Messiah to come. So the Messiah comes, and what did they try to do? Try to stone him. So it says Jesus hid himself from them, and he passed by. He walked through the midst of them, went out. As he was passing by, he saw this man who was blind from birth, and that's the subject of the 9th chapter. Now, Jesus came to our world as the greatest reformer that has ever been. And I want to read to you from the book Desire of Ages what would have happened if these leaders in Israel had not been fighting so furiously against him. It's almost impossible for us to imagine what would have happened. Let me read it to you. This is the book Desire of Ages, page 205. It says, if the priests and rabbis had not interposed, his teaching would have wrought such a reformation as this world has never witnessed. What would have happened? There would have been a reformation in the world such as has never been witnessed. I've tried to imagine in my mind for many years what would have happened. We can't really imagine what would have happened. What would have happened if, you know, the Jews were organized? And they had synagogues all over the Roman Empire. And they were in contact with these synagogues all over the Roman Empire. And what would have happened if they had sent delegates to every one of these synagogues and said, look, tell all the people in your area that the Messiah is here, and that if you come to Judea, you can be healed of any disease that you have, any trouble, that he can solve it. You know what would have happened? People would have flocked there from all over the world. And when they got healed, they wouldn't just want to be healed of their physical infirmities. They'd want to know, who is this person, and what does he teach, and what am I supposed to learn from this person? And we can't even imagine what would have happened. Now, when Jesus was here, he trained 12 disciples. And I want to read to you what their mission was. They were to carry on the reformation that Jesus had started. This is Desire of Ages, page 291. It says, Jesus had called his disciples that he might send them forth as his witnesses to declare to the world what they had seen and heard of him. Their office was the most important to which human beings had ever been called, and was second only to that of Christ himself. They were to be workers together with God for the saving of the world. So the reformation that Jesus had started, it actually started through the work of John the Baptist. That reformation was to be carried on by Jesus' disciples. Now, when you study this subject, you'll find out that you never have a reformation unless there is, first of all, a reformer. Now, being a reformer is a job where there are always more vacancies than there are occupants. There are always more opportunities for reformers than we have reformers. That's always been the case. Have you ever asked yourself the question, why is this? When this is one of the most necessary jobs in the world, we just read about the disciples that their mission was second in importance only to Christ Himself. When it's that important, how is it that we don't have more reformers? Why is this? When being a reformer is a job that has the greatest opportunities and privileges and the greatest rewards of any job that any young person could choose, why is it that has never been popular? Now, as I have studied the history of God's people down through the ages, I have been impressed over and over again with the fact that the greatest opportunities have been passed by almost every time by the great majority. These people that were alive, we just read it in John 8:59, they tried to stone him. You realize these people had the greatest spiritual opportunity of any generation that had lived since the beginning of the world. But when you study the history of God's people down through the ages, you find that the greatest opportunities have been passed by over and over again by the majority. And by the way, that will happen again. Let me read to you a prophecy about it happening in the future. This is from 15 Manuscript Releases, page 312. It says, He, that is God, will raise up from among the common people men and women to do His work, even as of old He called fishermen to be His disciples. There will soon be an awakening that will surprise many. Those who do not realize the necessity of what is to be done will be passed by. Did you get it? What's going to happen? They're going to be passed by. And the heavenly messengers will work with those who are called the common people, fitting them to carry the truth to many places. If you're one of the common people, be of good courage. You're part of the group that God is going to use to finish this work. Why is this? Why do God's people? Notice in Jesus' day, all the people that you thought were the people that would accept the Messiah, the people that were spiritual people, they got passed by. As Jesus went through the midst of them, He passed by. This is the greatest opportunity of your life. It's passing by. You're not going to get it. Because you don't. Why? Because, now listen, we're going to give the reasons. But the short answer is that God's people do not realize the opportunity. Because the opportunity is not visible to your physical senses, your eyes and ears. It's going to be that way again. Here are some of the main reasons that most people are passed by. Number one, turn in your Bible to Matthew, the 10th chapter. Starting with verse 34. Do not think that I came to bring peace on earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And a man's foes will be those of his own household. He who loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and he who loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And he who does not take his cross and follow after me is not worthy of me. He who finds his life will lose it. And he who loses his life for my sake will find it. That's why it's not popular. to be a reformer, to be involved in revival reformation. Because to your natural sight, it looks like you're going to lose everything. You're going to have trouble at home. Jesus said, he that saves his life will lose it. This is illustrated, by the way, many times in the Bible. Turn over to Matthew 19. Start reading verse 16. Now behold, one came and said to him, good teacher, what good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life? So he said to him, why do you call me good? No one is good but one, that is God. But if you want to enter into life, keep the commandments. He said to him, which? Jesus said, you shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness. Honor your father and your mother, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. The young man said to him, all these things I have kept from my youth. What do I still lack? Jesus said to him, if you want to be perfect, go sell what you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come follow me. But when the young man heard that saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. What was the problem? He was afraid he'd lose everything. See, Jesus was making him an offer. This is the majesty of heaven, the one who today is sitting at the right hand of God in the throne room in heaven. This is the person talking to this young man. And he says to him, if you want to be perfect, go and sell your possessions and come and be with me. This is one of the most wonderful opportunities that has ever been given to any human being. But this young man missed it. Why did he miss it? Because he didn't realize the opportunity. All he could see, he thought he'd lose everything. If he would have gone and done that, would he have lost everything? Now, the disciples of Jesus, they were poor, but they did forsake what they did have and went and followed Jesus, and they had a question about this very thing, and they asked the Lord about it later on in the chapter. But Jesus gave the answer to that question in the Sermon on the Mount. If you look in Matthew 6, verse 33, seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. He's talking about food and clothing, what you have need of. I'll tell you a quick story. An evangelist that I knew was studying the Bible with a man who had a large contracting business. But even though he had a large contracting business, he was actually a subcontractor. He worked for even bigger contractors than him. And when this man found out about the law of God, and that the law of God tells us that we're to remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy, he said, if I do that, I might lose my job. I got a big business. Here's what the preacher told him. He said, look, if you choose to obey God, you may lose your job, but if you lose your job and you're not able to find other work and you go hungry, or in other words, your family suffers because you have chosen to follow Jesus, so you don't have food and clothing that you need, if that happens, please contact me and I will immediately quit preaching. I will lose my job too. And said, okay, I'll risk losing my job if you're willing to risk losing your job. Guess what happened? In that case, the Lord worked it out. He didn't even lose his job. I know of another person, however, who did lose their job, and he had to look for another job, and guess what? He ended up getting a job at a bank where he was making twice as much as he made in the first job. So you never know exactly how God is going to work it out, but be assured, friends, if you choose to make God first, the Lord is going to work it out. But That takes faith. That's what's hard. We don't understand how it's going to work out. That's why we get in trouble. We don't understand how is God going to work it out. God can work it out, and He hasn't told us how He's going to work it out. We just know that He's told us, if you put me, make me first, I'll work it out so that you have what you need. That's a first reason that it's unpopular to become a reformer. A second reason that it is unpopular to become a reformer is because of the loss of social advantages that it often entails. Now, one of the leading reformers in the time of the New Testament was John the Baptist. And we just read about him in our scripture reading. And if you noticed in Luke 1, verse 80, he was in the deserts. He didn't have much social life. And there were some reasons that he didn't have much social life. It was so that he could be a reformer. But to be a reformer, he lost many social advantages. And social advantages are painful to lose. Have you noticed that? I could tell you many stories. Young lady in Scotland who was a Protestant. The person that wanted to marry her was a Roman Catholic. She said, "No, I cannot. I'm a Protestant." You know what was the result of that? He became so angry that she wouldn't marry him that he arranged for her to be martyred, and she was killed. So she lost a lot of our social advantages because she chose to be part of the Protestant Reformation. There were only a very few Protestants in Germany and other Catholic countries in the 16th century. So if you're a young person and the person who wanted to marry you was a Catholic, if you were going to be part of the revival Reformation movement that was going on, it could mean that you could end up not being married. And there were thousands of young people all over Europe that had to make that kind of a decision. There are still people today that are involved in decisions like that. So that's the second reason that it is unpopular to be a reformer, because it could mean the loss of social advantages. And here is a third reason. A third reason that it is unpopular to be a reformer is because reformers often have to stand alone with tremendous opposition. Now, you just read down through spiritual history and you'll see that over and over again. Now, one of the best known examples of that, if you look in 1 Kings, the 19th chapter, 1 Kings, the 19th chapter, verse 14, this is Elijah. Elijah was a reformer. He says, "I have been very zealous for the Lord God of hosts, because the children of Israel have forsaken your covenant, torn down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they seek to take my life." If you study the life of Elisha, or Isaiah, or Jeremiah, or John the Baptist, or Paul, or Martin Luther, you will see over and over again that reformers had to stand alone with tremendous opposition. And there's a lot of people saying, "Oh, I don't want to do that. I better just go with the flow." Trouble is, the flow is going downhill. So, let's look. We've looked at why being a reformer is very unpopular, but let's look at the work of a reformer? What is the work of reformers? Well, here's what Ellen White writes in the book Prophets and Kings, page 678. In the time of the end, every divine institution is to be restored. The breach made in the law at the time the Sabbath was changed by man is to be repaired. God's remnant people standing before the world as reformers are to show that the law of God is the foundation of all enduring reform, and that the Sabbath of the fourth commandment is to stand as a memorial of creation, a constant reminder of the power of God. In clear, distinct lines, they are to present the necessity of obedience to all the precepts of the Decalogue. Constrained by the love of Christ, they are to cooperate with Him in building up the waste places. They are to be repairers of the breach, the restorer of paths to dwell in. So, did you recognize the scripture that was being quoted? If you recognize a scripture that is being quoted, that is a scripture about the work of reform that is to be conducted in the world in the last days. And it can only be conducted by people who are willing to be part of the few people who are willing to be reformers. Turn in your Bible to that chapter. It's in Isaiah 58. Isaiah 58. Start reading verse 6. Is this not the fast that I have chosen? To loose the bonds of wickedness. Think through as we're reading this that there's somebody that you know that needs this applied to their case. To undo the heavy burdens. To let the oppressed go free. And that you break every yoke. Is it not to share your bread with the hungry, that you bring it to your house the poor who are cast out, when you see the naked that you cover him, and not hide yourself from your own flesh? Then, that's the work of reform in verses 6 and 7. Now it says, if you do that, this is what's going to happen. Then your light shall break forth as like the morning. Your healing shall spring forth speedily. And your righteousness shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry, and He will say, Here I am. If you take away the yoke from your midst, the pointing of the finger and speaking wickedness, if you extend your soul to the hungry and satisfy the afflicted soul, then your light shall dawn in the darkness. And your darkness shall be as the noonday. The Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your soul in drought and strengthen your bones. And you shall be like a watered garden and like a spring of water whose waters do not fail. What does that mean? Well, if you ought to know what that verse means, Jesus referred to it in John, the 7th chapter. Notice Jesus referred to this very verse. Look in John, the 7th chapter, and verse 38. Jesus says, He who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. That's the spring that Isaiah is talking about here at the end of verse 11. What are these rivers of living water that's going to flow out? It's explained in verse 39. But this he spoke concerning the Spirit, whom those believing in him would receive, for the Holy Spirit was not yet, because Jesus was not yet glorified. Notice the context here. Isaiah tells you, if you do these things, this is the work of reform. If you do these things, then when you pray, the Lord's going to answer. When you ask something, He's going to say, Here I am. And also, The Lord is going to guide you continually, satisfy your soul in drought, strengthen your bones, and you will be like a watered garden and like a spring of water whose waters do not fail. In other words, you're going to have the Holy Spirit. This is the way we prepare the way to receive the Holy Spirit. Verse 12. Those from among you shall build the old waste places. You shall raise up the foundations of many generations. And you shall be called the repairer of the breach. What does it mean to be a repairer of the breach? Turn your Bible to Daniel 11. Daniel 11. And verse 14. And I'll read you a literal translation. Daniel 11, 14. And in those times many shall rise up against the king of the south. Also certain who make a breach of your people shall exalt themselves in fulfillment of the vision, but they shall fall. There's a certain people predicted in prophecy that will make a breach of God's people. They're described here in Daniel 11, 14. A certain group of people that are going to make a breach of God's people. But that breach is to be repaired. That's Isaiah 58, 11, 12. It says, you shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of streets to dwell in, if. Who is it that's going to be the repairer of the breach, the restorer of the streets to dwell in? Here's who it's going to be. Verse 13. If you turn away your foot from the Sabbath, from doing your pleasure on my holy day, and call the Sabbath a delight, the holy day of the Lord, honorable, and shall honor him, not doing your own ways, nor finding your own pleasure, nor speaking your own words, then you shall delight yourself in the Lord, and I will cause you to ride on the high hills of the earth, and feed you with the heritage of Jacob your father. The mouth of the Lord has spoken. Isaiah 58 describes the work of a reformer. This was the work of John the Baptist. And why is this work so difficult? Let me read you a little description of the work that John the Baptist was called to do. This is from the book Desire of Ages, page 101. It says, as a prophet, John was to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. In preparing the way for Christ's first advent, he was a representative of those who are to prepare a people for our Lord's second coming. The world is given to self-indulgence. By the way, have you noticed it? Is the world where you live given to self-indulgence? Errors and fables abound. Satan's snares for destroying souls are multiplied. All who would perfect holiness in the fear of God must learn the lessons of temperance and self-control. The appetites and passions must be held in subjection to the higher powers of the mind. Remember what we read in Luke, the first chapter in our scripture? Strict instructions were given concerning temperance, self-control in regard to the life of John the Baptist. Because the world in which we live, just like the world in which he lived, is given to self-indulgence. To be ready for the second coming of Christ, we must learn the lessons of temperance and self-control. It is hard for us as human beings to take responsibility for what we do. Many years ago, this is a true story. It happened at an evangelistic meeting, I think it was in Oklahoma. Pretty sure it was in Oklahoma. The evangelist that had this happen to told it to me personally. He had a song leader, and this song leader was leading the song service for the evangelistic meeting. I don't remember what kind of a mistake he made, but he tried to brush it off, and he said, well, the devil made me do it. Guess what happened? The next night, he had nobody else at the meeting. They didn't want to be at a meeting where people had the devil were making people do things. But that is a human problem. We don't want to take responsibility. We want to say that it's my mother's fault for what I inherited, my father's fault for what I inherited, it's because I'm Irish, or it's because of this or that or 50 other things. And so we excuse our self-indulgence. John the Baptist had to give an example of self-control. That's why, notice what it says about John the Baptist in Matthew 11. This is Jesus talking. It says, John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say he has a demon. Why did he come in such an austere way? The people had to understand, if you're going to be ready for the Messiah, you have to get over your habits of self-indulgence and learn to practice self-control. Somebody says, well, that's impossible. Yes, it is impossible unless you receive the Holy Spirit. I want to talk now for just a few minutes about the rewards of being a reformer. I told you already that being a reformer is a job that has the greatest opportunities and privileges and the greatest rewards of any job that any young person could choose. But not very many choose it because of the disadvantages that I've mentioned. Can't live for yourself. Can't live for yourself, all your self-gratification. You can't live for self-indulgence. You can't live just for social advantages or material advantages and be a reformer. So very few people choose it. However, as I mentioned, it is a job that has the greatest... by the way, there's lots of vacancies all over the world. Plenty of job opportunities. And it has the greatest opportunities and the greatest rewards of any job that any young person could choose. Let's read about that. Look in your Bible in Mark, the 10th chapter. Starting with verse 28. Then Peter began to say to him, see, we have left all and followed you. Peter, he was a poor man, but he was a successful fisherman. And his fellows, these people were married men, and they had families to support. And the time came, it's recorded, that Jesus said to them, well, I want you to follow me. And it says they left their boats and their nets. They left everything, and they followed Jesus, and they didn't know how they were going to be supported. And so now Peter's thinking, well, now we have done all this. Well, now what's going to happen? What's going to be the reward for us doing all this? Notice what Jesus says. So Jesus answered and said, assuredly I say to you, there is no one who has left house or brethren or sisters or father or mother or wife or children or lands for my sake in the Gospels, who shall not receive a hundredfold now in this time, houses and brothers and sisters and mothers and children and lands with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. There is an age to come, you know. And let's go back and read it in the book of Matthew. Everybody in the age to come is not going to have the same reward. Have you ever thought about that? Everybody in the age to come is not going to... Now, they're all going to have eternal life, but everybody is not going to receive the same reward. Let's read that. Look in Matthew 19. Jesus said to them, "As surely I say to you that in the regeneration, when the Son of Man sits on the throne of His glory, you who have followed Me..." These are people who decided to be part of the Revival and Reformation movement. "You who have followed Me will also sit on 12 thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel, and everyone who has left houses or brothers or sisters or father or mother or wife or children or lands for My name's sake shall receive 100-fold and inherit everlasting life." Now, notice carefully. I've studied verse 29 for many years. Whatever you have left. Now, by the way, have some people left more than others? Yes, they have. Some people have left more than others. And Jesus said, whatever you have left for My sake, you're going to receive 100-fold. Now, by the way, this is a good investment. In this world, lots of people send me advice about investments. By the way, when you're dealing with worldly investments, you need to always remember that every worldly investment you have someday is all going to burn up. That's a good thing to remember. But in worldly investments, some people think that, you know, I've had people tell me, well, if you could make 6%, that would be... I said, no, I don't want to make 10%. Let me ask you this question. How many percent is 100-fold? Now, come on, some of you can figure that out. How many? Thank you. That's 10,000%. I don't know about you, friends. I've never had an investment that returned 1,000%, 10,000%. I did have an investment one time that returned 1,500%, and when that happens, you say to yourself, why didn't I invest 10 times as much in that? But that, of course, is too late then. But this is an investment. What is the result? What is the return for being a reformer? Whatever you leave, whatever you lose. Actually, if you ever get a hold of what we're studying right now, you'll begin to think like the Apostle Paul. The more you lose, the happier you get. Because you know that whatever you lose, you're going to get 100-fold. Not very many people are at that level yet. Time is going rapidly. I want to be realistic. You need to understand, if you want to be a reformer, that being a reformer is a very dangerous work. Dangerous work. I remember one evening, it was 1988, and Elder Ron Spear and myself, we were riding in a car over at Thompsonville, Illinois. We were, back in those days, people that were totally unaffiliated with the conference like us could do filming at 3ABN, and that's what we were doing. And we were talking, and Pastor Spear said to me, he said, well, he says, I'm not afraid of bullets. But he said, he's talking to me about how dangerous it is to be a reformer. He said, you look back through history. It's dangerous to be a reformer. Well, why is it so dangerous? Well, if you decide to become a reformer, here's two of the things that happen to a large percentage of reformers. Number one, at some point in time, they go off into some kind of fanaticism. Just study history. Well, just look at the reformers that have been in the Second Advent movement in the last 30 years. You figure that out. Go into fanaticism, one. And the other is, go back into the world and into apostasy and life of sin. You see, it's dangerous. And it involves sometimes loss in this world. Here's what Ellen White mentions about it in talking about the Apostle Paul. She says, reformatory action is always attended with loss, sacrifice, and peril. It always rebukes love of ease, selfish interests, and lustful ambition. Hence, whoever initiates or prosecutes such action must encounter opposition, calumny, and hatred from those who are unwilling to submit to the conditions of reform. It is no easy matter to overcome sinful habits and practices. My dear friends, we need to face reality. Every one of us, are you listening? Every one of us have sinful habits and practices that we must overcome. And it says here, that is no easy matter. Now, your sinful habit or practice may be something that only goes on in your mind, and nobody in the world may know about it. But let me tell you, it's all written in God's book. The work can be accomplished only with the help of divine grace, but many neglect to seek such help and endeavor to bring down the standard to meet their deficiencies instead of bringing themselves up to meet the standard of God. So, they go back into apostasy because they're not willing to come up to that highest standard, or they go into fanaticism. I want to read, in closing, a couple of statements from the book Desire of Ages that I hope will be an encouragement to you. Remember we read from John 8:59, how that Jesus, they took up stones to stone him, and he walked through the midst of them and passed by. Now we think when we're reading the story that it was just the Jewish leaders that were passed by. They were not the only ones. In one sense, the whole world was passed by, including the disciples. Here's what happened later. It says, after they had received the baptism of the Spirit, they began to realize that they had been in the very presence of the Lord of glory. They had had an opportunity that they did not comprehend. The wonders of His life passed before them, and they were as men awakened from a dream. The disciples now seemed to themselves of much less importance than before they realized this. They never wearied of rehearsing His words and works. Looking upon Him in His humiliation as He walked a man among men, they had not understood the mystery of His incarnation, the dual character of His nature. Their eyes were holden so that they did not fully recognize divinity in humanity. They had the most marvelous opportunity, but they didn't fully take advantage of it because they didn't really comprehend the opportunity. Sometimes in my own meditation, I say to myself, 500 years from now, when you're looking over the record of your life, are you going to say, Lord, why did I let the opportunity that You gave me pass by because I didn't see it? Maybe now would be a good time, before that happens, to say, Lord, what is the spiritual opportunity that is in front of me now that one of these days will be gone, pass by forever? And then I'll say, oh, Lord, why didn't I see the opportunity that I had? Now is our time of opportunity. What are we to do? This is Desire of Ages, page 350. The followers of Christ are to labor as He did. We are to feed the hungry, clothe the naked, and comfort the suffering and afflicted. We are to minister to the despairing. You know anybody like that? And inspire hope in the hopeless. You know anybody like that? And to us also the promise will be fulfilled, thy righteousness shall go before thee, the glory of the Lord shall be your rearward. The love of Christ manifested in unselfish ministry will be more effective in reforming the evildoer. By the way, do you know any evildoers that need to be reformed? How's that going to be done? Now notice how it works. Notice how reform can happen to an evildoer. Here's the way. It says, the love of Christ manifested in unselfish ministry will be more effective in reforming the evildoer than will the sword or the court of justice. That's all some people want. Give them what they deserve so they'll learn their lesson. They may learn their lesson. But let me tell you, friend, any evildoer that needs to be reformed will be reformed much more effectively by finding out about the love of Christ than he or she will by any type of justice that could be administered. When this world fell into transgression, the Lord could have in justice destroyed it. That could have happened. But he said, no, I'm going to make a way. I'm going to make a way so that you can be recovered. You can be reformed. You can be changed. You don't have to die eternal death. Even though you've sinned grievously, your sins can be forgiven and you can be transformed in character. We are to cooperate in helping others find out about this plan of grace, this plan of salvation that has been offered, not just to us, but, my dear friend, the plan of salvation is offered right now to the weakest people and to the chief of sinners. And it has the power to change the way people talk and the way people think and the way people act so that they're completely transformed into a reflection of the character of Christ instead of the reflection of the character of the devil. Ellen White writes, often the heart will harden under reproof, but it will melt under the love of Christ. Through His servants, God designs that the sick, the unfortunate, those possessed of evil spirits, shall hear His voice. Only problem is, God needs some reformers. Some people that are willing to cooperate with Him in His work. And in our generation, people are so absorbed in whatever they're doing. It could be making a living, could be getting an education, could be a hunt, it could be all sorts of good things, but people are so absorbed in what they're doing, there's very few people that have time to get actively involved in God's work. It's unpopular. I'm giving you the reason why it's unpopular. But would you like to be one of those that gets actively involved in God's work as a reformer? If you and I don't do it, friend, God's going to get somebody else to do it. In Jesus' day, because the priests and rulers didn't cooperate, there came a time when the children were shouting forth the praise of Jesus, and they said, make them be quiet. Jesus said, if these people be quiet, the stones will cry out. They're doing it because you didn't do it. Now you don't want them to do it. So, if you don't do it, if I don't do it, God will find somebody else to do it. We will get passed by. In my own personal devotions, I've said more than once to the Lord, Lord, I'm willing to be a doorkeeper in your work, but Lord, I don't want to be passed by. That's the one thing I don't want to happen. You don't want to be passed by. God's work is soon going to be finished. Time is gone. I can't tell you any more stories. I'll tell you this just real quickly. I was thinking about this to the Lord this morning. Lord, in heaven, you can choose for me to live by whoever you want me to live by, but in the kingdom of heaven, I want to live next door to a reformer. If you want to live next door to a reformer in heaven, be a good idea to become one here. Let's pray before we sing our closing song. Father in heaven, we thank you that when we were ruined, that you devised a way by sending your Son to this world to help us to find out what the rest of the universe is like, how they operate. And Lord, we pray that you'll help us to understand that our principles, our motives, must be changed if we are going to be in the kingdom of heaven. Help us to understand that nothing of an earthly nature, of a sinful nature, is going to be in that place. And we earnestly pray that by the power of your Holy Spirit, that we might become a reformed people, so that one day when Jesus comes, we might be allowed to dwell with the reformers of this world from all ages. We pray in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen.
We hope that this sermon has been a blessing to you. We would love to hear from you. Our mailing address is Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782-828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. You may call us at 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. Our email address is historic@stepstolife.org, and our web address is www.stepstolife.org. May God be with you as you seek to walk the narrow way.